Hello, everyone, and welcome to Mr. This is a map of Asia, and here is Afghanistan. It has only been called Afghanistan, which means place or land of the Afghans, since the mid-1700s. Before that, it had a number of names and underwent a whole lot of history. Now let's dash through it all, shall we? Somewhere between 3000 and 2000 BC, urban communities began arising in the land. This may have coincided with the arrival of the Iranian peoples, who would later dominate the region. They certainly would have traded with the neighboring Indus Valley civilization. And indeed, Indus towns like Shortugai have been found in Afghanistan. For those who don't know, the Indus Valley civilization was among the earliest civilizations ever to appear on the planet. In northern Afghanistan, later called Bactria by the Greeks, there existed from around 2300 to 1700 BC a civilization located on the Oxus River, where farming communities supported a culture of big buildings and where there were skilled metal workers who made cool stuff like this. Assyrian and Median rule ensued, and sometime later, the land we know as Afghanistan was conquered by the Persians under Darius I in around 515 BC. Before and during this time, the people followed the Zoroastrian religion, and it is thought that the prophet Zoroaster lived and died in Afghan lands. Afghan peoples, like the Bactrians, were recruited into the Persian army to fight Persia's wars, including the failed invasions of Greece. Greek revenge for this came with Alexander the Great. He conquered the Persian Empire, which of course included Afghanistan, and left Greeks in control. Greek influence and culture spread everywhere, coexisting and fusing with Buddhism, which was introduced from India, and a treaty made with the Mauryan dynasty of India gave the Indian crown rule over much of Afghanistan. It seems strange, but there were Greek cities in Afghanistan, with theaters and temples and Corinthian columns and marble statues and gymnasiums and so on, and good diplomatic relations with India, in whose courts were Greek ambassadors. Anyway, as ever, it ended. Grecian rule divided and declined, and as usual, invaders pounced on the limping prey. The pouncers in question were the Indo-Scythians, a branch of a widespread nomadic Iranian people, and much of Afghan land fell to their rule. Later, the land ended up under Parthian Persian rule. Total Persian control did not last, and the distinct Indo-Parthian kingdom came about, known today mainly for its Greco-Buddhist art. Then what happened? Well, you may not know it, but the ancient inhabitants of much of western China were Caucasian, and one such tribe, known as the Yuezhi, were attacked by another Caucasoid Chinese people, the Wusun, and migrated west out of Gansu, eventually settling in, you guessed it, Afghanistan. They rose to dominance, joined in the swirling cultural concoction of Greek, Buddhist, Zoroastrian, and Hindu influence, and established the Kushan Empire. The Kushan Empire, which expanded this far at its height. Kushan rulers, like Kanishka I, were great champions of Buddhism, and were instrumental in transmitting that religion to China via the Silk Road trading route. In 225, the Kushan Empire split in half, and the western Afghan half was gobbled up by the Persians again. Their rule was interrupted by the arrival of another nomadic people, the Hunnar tribes, maybe related to the Huns, who ruled for around a century and didn't do much. The Sasanian Persians defeated them in 565, and Afghanistan had some decades of relative stability. Enter the Arabs. In 642, the Arabs invaded, bringing their new religion, Islam. It took 150 years to subdue the hardy Afghan mountain fighters, but Islam took root in the land and has dominated it ever since. Arab military might did not last, nor did the Arabic language spread, but Islam did both in the region. As the centuries passed, various Muslim dynasties fought each other for control of the land, which became more and more Persian in culture. Afghan cities like Balkh and Herat became rivals to Baghdad in Islamic civilization, but that didn't last because, do you hear that? It's the Mongols! Genghis Khan's invasion of Afghanistan was rapid and brutal, and the great centers of culture were totally trashed, cities destroyed and their people mass slaughtered, pushing Afghanistan back into a dark age of backwardness. Ironically, a descendant of Genghis Khan, Timur, was the one who later rebuilt and beautified Afghan cities. From the 1500s to the 1700s, Afghanistan was split between the rule of Mughal India, Safavid Persia, and the Turkic Khanate of Bukhara. In 1722, Afghan armies under Mahmud Hotak actually conquered Persia, but this only lasted a few years as the unlucky Afghans had to face maybe the greatest military leader in Persia's history, Nadir Shah, who promptly defeated them. When Nadir was assassinated, Ahmed Shah Durrani was chosen as the king of Afghanistan, whose conquests included the invasion of India, taking the Punjab region away from the infidel Hindus, and sacking Delhi and Amritsar, where he slaughtered the Sikhs and destroyed their golden temple. However, as seen so often in history, military success alone cannot guarantee or sustain a land's stability, and the Durrani Empire soon began to weaken in power. Afghanistan then had to deal with enemies on both sides, Persia to the west and the Sikhs in the east, both of whom regained lands from Afghan rule. And then along came the British, who were concerned that Russia might have its eyes on Afghanistan. The Brits Soviets invaded and eventually won, but did not add the land to the British Empire, but rather let Afghanistan remain independent, wishing to keep it as a buffer between them and the Russians. The British kept the upper hand, controlling Afghan foreign relations, and this eventually caused the Afghan invasion of British India in 1919. The result was a stalemate, but Afghanistan gained independence, while agreeing not to attack British-held lands. Many Afghan politicians at this time, like Mahmud Tarzi, were reform-minded, opposing religious extremism, promoting education, wanting to westernize and secularize the nation, and maybe even give women a bit of freedom. In 1923, slavery was abolished. But when the reforms started encroaching into the realm of burqa banning, many Afghan tribal leaders, all men of course, were outraged. There followed a troubled time of leaders abdicating or being assassinated. Now, while it remained neutral during the Cold War, Afghanistan happily accepted Soviet-Russian development aid, with Russia building up Afghan infrastructure, roads and airports. In 1973, the monarchy was abolished by this guy, Daoud Khan, who became the first president, but was assassinated in 1978 by this guy, who was later killed by the KGB. The Saur Revolution saw the communists get control of Afghanistan, but again, their ideas of reform angered their traditionally minded Muslim populace. Of course there was a civil war, and the violence went on and on and on until... well, it hasn't actually ended yet. Now, division in the Communist Party led to a leadership change, which displeased Moscow and led to the Soviet 40th Army entering Kabul and putting a pro-Soviet leader in power. While the Soviets did not plan on a long stay, they were met with such fierce resistance that the conflict was prolonged for nearly 10 years, during which time the Russians held the cities while the Mujahideen rebels held the countryside, receiving military aid from Pakistan, money from Saudi Arabia, and training and support from America. After the Soviets withdrew, the violence was far from over, as various factions disagreed and clashed and caused more chaos. In 1994, one faction began to rise in prominence, the Taliban, with its own particular plans for an Afghan utopia. With Pakistani support, it grew in power and conquered Kabul, and gained control of most of the country, imposing a harsh Sharia-based totalitarian regime, and destroying ancient Buddhist monuments. Taliban rule was fertile soil for the growth of Al-Qaeda, a militant organization who believed that the West wanted to get rid of Islam. It was Al-Qaeda and its Saudi leader, Osama bin Laden, who were the immediate suspects of instigating the September 11 attack in New York City, and the US speedily invaded Afghanistan and easily toppled the Taliban regime. Bin Laden escaped into Pakistan, however, where he hid for 10 years before being killed by US Navy SEALs in Operation Neptune Spear. But the Taliban persists in its efforts at regaining power. NATO troops remain in Afghanistan, training and supporting the government troops. Two-thirds of Al-Qaeda's operatives have been killed or captured, but it isn't over yet. How do you think it will end? Comment below, but for now, bye-bye!